gee, comedy is not evergreen, you know?
What do you mean?
I mean, you know, if you're not looking back at what you did 10 years ago and cringing, you're probably doing something wrong.
I'm such a big fan, and we're such a big fan of yours, and we're big fans of the podcast here too.
Woo, thank you.
I love how the podcast ends with you kind of talking about your dad.
Well, that's because my dad always listens to it, and he ri okay, my dad rides a like an adult tricycle. So he's 85. He won't get a rascal because he, you know, that's what old people and people in Vegas do. So I got him a tricycle. It's an electric tricycle, and he feels very cool on it, and I don't have to worry about him falling off his bike, you know? Because, you know, at 85, I mean, really, when I say goodbye to him on the phone, I always just say, "Don't fall." But so anyway, he listens to it on his tricycle. And he goes, "It's just jarring when you suddenly end it. Like, I need a warning." And I just got in the habit of warning him. And I said, I would say, "Dad, we're rounding down." And then months after doing that, somebody called in and said, "What do you mean rounding down? You mean winding down?" And
Oh,
I
yeah.
thought about it and I went, "Oh,
Yeah.
yeah." And by the way, I would never round down. I always round
Yeah, you
up.
gotta round up, especially for tips. Yeah,
Oh, my
I think it's
gosh.
really sweet that your dad listens to the show.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's the only one I know for sure listens, him and my stepmom, Janice, you know. But I'm always surprised when people, that people listen, and I'm always shocked. You know, I'm such an ugly American. I'm not worldly, that I'm always shocked because we get so many calls from all over the world.
Yeah.
And it didn't occur to me that podcasts go, anyone can access a podcast. So it's very cool, you know.
Your dad was sort of a formative figure in someone laughing at you in the early days, right?
Yes, he, I mean, you know, it's interesting because I was just talking on my podcast about that, just answering someone's question about writing about your childhood.
Yeah.
Because I wrote about my childhood when I wrote my book, The Bedwetter, and now it's, you know, it's become a musical and we're still working on it for its next phase. And someone asked about, right, you know, getting in touch with your childhood self, and so I was explaining you have to kind of be a detective in your own life, which really ended up being fruitful just to me as a person, as a human being. You know, it occurs to me that that's a good thing to do, even if you're not writing a book or a play. But that's when I really realized kind of my origin, my not superhero origin story, which is, besides the fact that I think 100% of comedians become funny out of survival. You know, I'm sure when you've interviewed comedians, they've said something to the effect, or have said something that proves my theory that they had to become funny in order to survive childhood.
Yeah.
Just like everyone develops survival skills to survive their childhood. For comedians, it's being funny.
Yeah.
And certainly that was the case for me. But in terms of that, I was really started out, especially with a kind of shock humor, makes sense because I had one of those dads who taught his 3-year-old swears because he thought it was hilarious.
Yeah.
And I was 3 and he taught me a bunch of swears, and we were standing in the middle of Boys Market in Manchester, New Hampshire, and I yelled my line of swears he taught me. And I do remember this. I remember grown-ups all around me giving me this kind of wild approval despite themselves. And it made my arms itch with glee. You know what I mean? Like, and that became the thing, that became the drug where I found that I could say shocking things and get and get many fruits from it, you know.
Right, because I was curious about that. So you have that experience, like you get a laugh from strangers, you shock strangers, and like something happens.
Shock humor.
Because I what I'm always curious about with comedians is like, how do you go from I'm the funny person in my social circle, or like I'm the funny person in my family, to like I want to make a lot of people laugh, not just the people who are close to me, you know?
I think I got so addicted to that feeling so young and in my formative years, and certainly it was how I was able to cope within a family built from a very unstable, unloving marriage.
Yeah.
And how it got me to survive being, you know, my parents are atheists. I mean, they're agnostic, which is like polite atheists. I mean, or really, I'm agnostic. I think of atheist to me is to be as sure as something unknowable as religion.
You're still believing in something. Like you're still, to believe in nothing requires belief. Agnosticism is sort of.
Yeah, like there's no way I could possibly know and I'm not trying to.
I understand, yeah.
But anyway, but still we were, and this is how Judaism is a race, is an ethnicity, and all these things beyond being a religion, because we're certainly godless Jews, and people go, you can be godless Jews? Yes, but I was aware of being Jewish because there were no other Jews, and I had that feeling. My friend Brian Moses and I both talked about it, and he's Black and he grew up around white people, and I'm Jewish and I grew up around white people. And, you know, and this feeling that certainly as kids we couldn't articulate, but that we both bonded over, which is this feeling that we had to make our friends' parents, we knew somehow inside us we had to make our friends' parents comfortable with us.
With you, yeah.
And make them know that their kids are safe hanging out with us, you know, and politeness and doing well in school and being funny was my way in for that.
But the stand-up wasn't polite. Like, was the stand-up shocking stuff at the beginning too? Like, when you were 17 and doing stand-up, were you shocking off the top?
No, it was a little softer, but it was, you know, because I, when I first was doing stand-up, I had not had experiences with sex or drugs or any kind of adult things, you know? And then as I did, you know, I lost my virginity as a stand-up. I started taking drugs as a stand-up. I talked about all those, the things I was experiencing. But I talked about high school stuff, you know, when I was 17. I talked about the popular girls. I talked about the, you know, not having, I was flat chested until I was like 18. I was a very late bloomer physically.
Yeah, you had a joke about that, right? And then you had to stop doing the joke?
It's very embarrassing. I had like a parody song that went to Barbara Streisand's memories called Mammaries.
Right,
you can like write the rest.
Yeah,
it was
okay, right.
Very basic. And it wasn't until a comedian said, "This doesn't make sense. You have tits." And I was like, oh my God, I do. You forget that my body was changing and all these things happened whilst being a teenage stand up. But, you know, also being, shock being my kind of starting my love of comedy and then becoming my kind of bread and butter initially, it made it very hard after my first special, which was just like the accumulation of the best stuff I had put together in 10 years of stand-up. It was hard to then surprise people, because giving people what they wanted would be surprising them. But if you're giving them what they wanted, that's not a surprise. And I became, it was a real identity crisis until I had to realize that comedy dies in the second guessing of what the audience wants from you, and that you have to be willing to eat shit all over again, you know, bomb and start over, and really just stick to who you are now.
Yeah.
And what's funny to you and what's amusing to you. And if you lose fans, fine, you might gain fans, but it just can't be part of the creative plan.
But like, didn't you learn that at SNL? Like, didn't, like, the story, as I understand about SNL, you go there, you work there. It doesn't really work out for a bunch of reasons. Bob Odenkirk has even like said, like, there's Sarah was funnier than that place. Like, you know, there was no way that that was really going to work out.
That's very kind, yeah. But I don't know that that's true.
But the way I love you talking about it, because what reminds me of it with what you were just talking about is I've heard you talk about how, like, I want to acknowledge that I failed there and that failure is okay and you can learn from it.
I failed constantly and a lot in a row where I was like, am I in show business? I'm not sure yeah. anymore.
At what point am I just not doing it anymore?
Yeah. Like getting fired from Saturday Night Live. Like I let that be my identity for a year.
Yeah.
And then, this is who I am now. And then it wasn't. And I was shocked. It never occurred to me, you know, where I think a lot of comics are like, I'm going to get fired. That never occurs to me. and so I was stunned. And then I was like, well, who am I then? And I just went back to the drawing board of stand-up, which is my constant that I'm so grateful for.
Yeah.
And in this life that I've been able to do all these odd jobs, this is my one constant. And the one constant is always changing because, comedy is not evergreen. You know,
what do you mean?
I mean, you know, if you're not looking back at what you did 10 years ago and cringing, you're probably doing something wrong.
Are you doing
in my view?
Are you doing
because,
that?
Because, yeah.
How about you mean?
I mean, look, my first special is problematic in 18 different ways.
Yeah.
Is there funny stuff? Absolutely. But, you know, as the world, you know, that's is as much as stand-ups don't like to think of themselves as what they do is art, you know, and the audience often doesn't. I mean, nobody heckles a ballerina, you know, like it's, but it is art. And the proof of that is that it changes with the times, you know,
yeah.
You can look at the same, let's say special year, you know, day after day or year after year, and what you see is going to change because the world around you is always changing and you are hopefully changing and the things happening, your life experience changes you and all those things make what you see different. So, you know, yeah, we live in a very different time than 12, 15 years ago, you know?
Yeah. I mean,
years ago.
I thought about that this morning, though, like when I was thinking about this interview, I was like, because I watched a bunch of your stuff last night and I was like, yeah, it was really shocking and it was shocking and wild and fun, but there was something I felt in on it. Like I felt like I was in on the, I'm not asking you to defend your old work. I'm asking you to talk about kind of the work now, because when I watched it, I felt like, oh, we're all kind of welcome into this sort of absurd, offensive, shocking place. Whereas I find now with like a lot of comics, like especially younger comics, their effort is almost like aggressive to like challenge me. Like they want me to not laugh so they can like feel righteous about it. Do you know what I mean by that?
I do. It, you know, on both sides of the like, quote unquote, cancel culture vibe. You know, like, I'm going to say this anyway, or I'm going to say this only the right way, and the black and whiteness between it and not seeing any of the, you know, that there's nuance to all of this. But, I mean, if you're talking about my first special, Jesus is Magic.
Yeah.
There's like N-word, hard R, you know, the R word. Is that enough to say?
Yeah, you can say that. Yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's Canada. You're okay.
M-word for little person.
Yeah.
I'm not saying this out of fear, but just out of being mindful.
Yeah.
Because once you learn something, you can't unring that bell unless you, you know, Unless you decide you're going to just know something cuts people and say it anyway.
But some people do that. Some people do that.
Right. So, but, you know, I said all those things, and it certainly doesn't hold up. That said, I was Sarah Silverman, but that whole special's in character.
Yeah.
I'm playing the same ignorant arrogance that I then went on to play in the Sarah Silverman program. And I really loved that character. I think when Trump became president, that stuff became, he actually is an ignorant arrogant. And it's like, it felt like,
yeah,
it was very punishing. It was very, and it was very also to see what came up, what came out from under all the rocks that was there that would have maybe changed the perspective of, you know, what I did. I mean, I was obsessed with race and racism, and I, you know, even the episode on the Sarah Silverman program that can be seen nowhere anymore, but of course there's a picture of me in blackface that exists with no context, was all about that, you know. And would I do it today? Obviously not, you know, but it is frustrating to see something that was done with intentions, you know, with a lot of intention, specific intention.
Yeah.
And then all that's left is a screenshot that is horrifying.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, the consequences that come from it are, I accept wholeheartedly, because that's what art is. And sometimes you do stuff, you know, everyone wants to be this risky, edgy comic, but risky means there's risk,
yeah,
and consequence.
Yeah.
And you have to suck it up and take it, you know,
and learn or, you know, be open to it, you know?
Yeah. Just like, I'm into, growing, changing, all that shit. I'm into it, you know, but people, it is a human instinct to be very afraid of change and very afraid of, you know, I mean, even just with how upset people are about pronouns is like so odd to me. And it's very funny. I mean, listen, I want to get your pronouns right. I'm so down with it. And I fuck up, I don't know what I, you know, 100, maybe 100% of the time, but yeah. I'm trying, and I know that eventually it will be without thought. It will be muscle memory. And even the people fighting that today, it will be muscle memory for them, yeah, in 5 years. Like, it's so odd when they don't see the pattern of resisting and, yeah, then it just being normalized. But listen, we all learned Galifianakis from one Hangover movie. I'm sure we can do this. I believe in us.
But I feel like that leads to, like, I remember with I Love You, America, like, there was an effort I thought I saw there from you to, I guess, offer compassion or at least understanding to people who you would, like, vociferously not agree with politically.
Social media has made the world smaller in so many beautiful ways, but it's also, obviously, I'm not saying anything new, divided us immensely. And there's something we really lose when we're not face to face. I mean, I like almost everybody. There isn't anyone I usually like can find something I like or can, you know, I think that's a skill that comedians have. It's a real gift. It's a gift to me. It's a gift for us, but that we're able to connect with anyone. We can find some way to connect with anyone. And I think anyone could do that. But it's definitely something we practice a lot because it's our job. But I also see a very big difference between disingenuous politicians and the people and corporations that fill their coffers that buy policy and buy the extreme, you know, evangelical right that has such influence that can create policy. It's those disingenuous you know, I say this in my act in a context, but, you know, it's those disingenuous politicians chipping away at our rights that I hope go to the hell I don't believe in. But the people
yeah.
are, they just believe something. They believe them. You know, there's a difference between the liars and the lied to. And in my view, even though I don't agree with, you know, these people I would meet with on that show, you know, politically, 100% of the time I walked away loving them. I wasn't changed politically, but I loved them, you know, and they loved me. I believe, you know,
what do you learn from that? What do you learn from acknowledging that you love them?
That we're far more similar than we think. That this divided country is a mirage, a dangerous mirage, but a mirage, I think. And, you know, a big part of it, and this was the one thing I wanted to talk about on The Daily Show that I did the long piece on, and on the Thursday I did, is that if everyone can kind of understand the economy of anger, the fact that we are being made angry and rageful by the things we read by design,
yeah.
because it makes people money,
yeah.
because it gets clicks.
Yeah.
And even, you know, from all the different quote unquote news sites and all the 24-hour news, cable news sites that need content and need you angry, Fox News is the best at it, but all of the, on both sides, they need to keep you angry. One may be a little more beholden to the truth.
Yeah.
But a little. Yeah. yeah. But that we're all being duped in this way, and to go, gee, this headline makes me furious.
Yeah.
But, you know, for instance, I saw a headline that made me furious.
Yeah.
And it was that I think the Missouri Senate voted that the women senators cannot wear sleeveless shirts. And I thought, that is such bullshit. They're chipping away at our rights. And now the blah, blah, blah. And, you know, until I read a few more things about it. And one article pointed out, yeah, the men have to wear suits and ties. Like, there's a dress code. Right. But that headline was designed for me and people like me.
Yeah.
To be very angry.
Right.
And that's just wasted energy. And it builds a divide that is, there are plenty of things to be angry about going on right now. That's not one of them. Just, you know, just like it, I talked about on my podcast, a friend of mine who is a little more center right sent a headline. Did you see that headline? Like, LGBT group demands that Aretha Franklin, natural woman, be taken off the airwaves.
Yeah.
It was a prank.
Yeah.
It was a prank Twitter site,
yeah.
a fake parody site.
But it made us mad.
And by the way, that parody site, and it got picked up by a ton of news outlets.
Yeah.
And that parody site said not one of those outlets reached out to them. Not one.
Yeah.
So it's a rage machine, and
yeah.
you really have to learn, all of us need to be aware of it and learn how to decipher what is true.
Yeah.
you know?
Yeah. There's not a lot of money that can be made in compassion. There's not a lot of money that can be made in empathy and understanding. But yeah.
Although wellness is a booming business.
Oh, oh boy. yeah. We're in the wrong business. But I heard in you not anger or rage, but I heard fear recently. So I was listening to your podcast. Someone called in and they were talking about, like, hey, I'm a Jewish person. I'm working, I think it was a film set. And, you know, I'm starting to get a little bit of like flack for being Jewish. And I'm starting to get a little bit of heat. And people are saying, oh, I'm only getting these jobs because I'm Jewish. I should point out for people who don't know, you are Jewish, Sarah. And then I watched.
What? I don't know what you're talking about.
And then on the Daily Show, I saw you do the you're trying to find pro Semites on the Daily Show, not anti Semites. But in that answer, I think what I was expecting was like a real like, well, here's the thing, and here's what has to be done, and here's what's going on. But what I heard was you were kind of like, yeah, there's a lot of anti-Semitism right now. I can see the signs of some really bad stuff happening, and I don't really know what to do, and it's freaking me out. Like, I heard fear there. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. And it is fear. And my fear around fear, listen, there's Gavin De Becker's The Gift of Fear, which is listening to your gut, and that's a good thing. But/and?
Yeah.
Yeah. Jews in general are getting a little nervous, and we're seeing the signs we've been taught since birth to look at.
Yeah.
You know, and then just a lot of swastikas, a lot of, you know, my hometown of New Hampshire last weekend, 17 swastikas on every business owned by a Jew or a person of color and the like one temple in town, you know, like, yeah, sure. It's always kind of been that way here and there, sure.
Yeah.
But it's a lot lately.
But Sarah, here's what I'm hearing. Like, do you want to do the Daily Show? Like, you have a lot to say about like America right now. Like, you just did the Daily Show. Is that the gig?
Oh, I had so much fun. It was exhilarating. And by the end, I was like, I know how to do this. Listen, it would be such an honor. And I feel I could do well. But that's not the life at this point in my life. You know, I really wanted a political show. I really wanted it. But when the pandemic happened, I started this podcast and I didn't think it would be like this, but it is. And it really satiates that part of me, to be honest. I've a lot of less, many less people probably hear it, but it does it for me fine.
I got two things left for you before you go.
Okay.
One is,
can we talk about that I'm doing a show in fucking Toronto?
No.
Oh, okay, yeah.
No. No, we don't need to do.
It's not cool.
Hold on, Sarah. I can do that right now. Sarah's doing a show in Toronto.
Woohoo!
It's at Meridian Hall. I'm gonna be there.
You are?
I'll go. Yeah, I'm gonna go.
I have some friends going. I'm excited.
Do you have friends in Toronto?
Can you believe it?
I don't know. This story I heard about you in Toronto, the only story I know about you in Toronto one time is that you came to Toronto and I think they threw a party for you at some during the Toronto International Film Festival and you got kind of brought there and they threw a party but didn't invite anybody that you knew and it was uncomfortable and then you left. Isn't that the case? I don't mean to be nerd-bar here.
I don't remember that, but that sounds familiar. That's such a bummer. You know, it's like a party for you. It's not. It's a gig where you know no one.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, oh, I thought there'd be comics here. No, the one memory I have from, well, I have many, I love Toronto. I shot a movie there, a Sarah Polley movie, and that was an incredible experience. She's incredible. But one time I was at, maybe during that, I went and did a, like popped on at a comedy club. And, you know, I like, you know, hanging out with comics. Comics are like, you just already know them, even if you don't.
Because
we're like an island of misfit toys.
Yeah.
We hung out, had a little, smoked a little pot.
Hello.
And I do have a thing where I have very low blood pressure and I fainted in the street. I fainted right on the sidewalk and I was with some other comics. And they said, we're going to call the ambulance. And I said, no, please don't. I can't afford it. It was probably way before that movie, actually. And they said, it's free. And I was like, oh, my God. You know? But by then I was like, this happens. I just have to eat salt. And I convinced them to let me just go in a cab. And I was fine.
Oh, I'm glad. I'm glad they didn't charge you too.
Yeah.
I want to ask you about the Mel Brooks series you're in, The History of the World Part 2, which is the sequel to the original. Are you a Mel Brooks fan? Are you big into Mel Brooks?
You know, I mean, just my hero. I mean, and I, you know, he also was my like childhood crush. I was probably because he looked like my father and also because he's so hilarious and Jewish. You know, I didn't know Jews growing up, you know, and oh, I loved him so much. And he's I just love him. And his son is wonderful. He's got a family that is feels like Mishpucha, as yeah. they say. But I you know, listen, I wasn't able to really be in it because I was working on something else when they were shooting it. Mm-hmm. But I'm in a little tiny kind of Easter egg-y thing at the end of the last thing at the end.
This is History of the World Part 2. The History of the World Part 2.
I just went to the premiere of it. They showed the first two episodes and it just filled my heart. Yeah. It is so funny. It tries stuff. It's so free. It's so ridiculously silly. And it really is in the vein of the original whilst being original. And I just thought it felt like joy. It felt like, oh, I needed this. I needed it. So yeah. I'm excited for people to see it. I just think it's a blast.
I know you from the sketch work and like the stand up, but like my favorite way to know you is through the Larry Sanders Show, which is like my favorite thing in the entire world, which is Gary Shandling's show about this fake talk show. And then the Judd Apatow's movie, the Zen Diaries of Gary Shandling, like kind of changed my life. And I got to tell Judd about it one time in like a hallway at the Toronto Film Festival. And how it happened was this, and it made me think about what you were saying earlier. I was doing this show. This is a public radio show. I was trying to sound like a public radio host. I was like talking like this all the time. I was talking like that, you know? I tried to sound like I read The New Yorker as opposed to just subscribe to it and made
That's
a
like
stack
the first time
of them.
I did Terry Gross. I was like, you know, Terry, you know, I was just like talking the way I felt like you're supposed to talk on Fresh Air. And I was like, what am I doing?
I know. I pretended I knew stuff I didn't know. I tell you one thing. It went okay. It didn't go that well.
Right.
So there's this scene in the Gary Shandling documentary where he talks about walking up on stage and he has this piece of paper in his hand when he's about to go do stand up. And it says, don't be funny. Just be yourself.
Just be Gary.
Just be Gary,
Gary Shandling or something like that.
Don't be funny, just be Gary. And I was like, I'm going to try that. I'm not going to try to be smart. I'm not going to try to be charming. I'm not going to try to be funny. I'm not going to try to be entertaining. People listening to this going like, he's definitely not trying to be entertaining. But I was like, I'm just going to try to be me. And I got to say, it really helped my life. Like my life got better and my job got better. But my life got better when I decided, isn't that the best?
It's so beautiful. That's just so beautiful. And to me, that conceit really ties into Mr. Rogers, my other hero, because he says, you're the only person qualified to be you. And I like you just the way you are. Yeah. But that is the uniqueness of you is you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so corny and not funny.
But you
at
got
all.
That. You take that stuff into that. That means something to you too. Like for you and your own thing.
You know, Mr. Rogers is like my hero, and also Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and Gary.
Yeah, Gary Shandling.
And I have his ashes and a part of his ashes in a little necklace that a bunch of us got. You know, who were close with him, and I. Every once in a while, I wear it. Oh, you know, but not that I don't know, but I don't know what I believe. But Mr. Rogers, of course, I watched when I was little, but then when I was in high school, I started watching it before school randomly. And I really heard it in a totally new way. And then as an older adult again, and I just think he's everything you need to know about life is in that show.
But like, it made me think about you when you were talking. I know we have to go, but when you were talking about how like I did this kind of comedy and then I didn't, then I was like, okay, people are expecting me to play a character, and I need to dispel any expectations of my art and my work. And I thought, or maybe just started to be Sarah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Whoever that is.
Yeah.
Today.
All right. I hope.
Yeah. Anyway, I know you got to go.
I don't have to go, but I'm Sarah. I kept you from whatever you got to do next. Sorry about that.
We do have. My friend David is coming over. We have work to do.
I'm sorry. But, I didn't mean to keep you so long.
God damn it.
Sorry, buddy.
Mine too. I had such a good time talking to you.
I had a great time talking
and
to you, too.
And you are fantastic at being you.
Oh, thanks, buddy.
And this show. It's interesting. I love why. I was just listening to your last one.
What was I doing?
It was the comedian that became a comedian in his 30s who wanted to be a chef. and his whole origin story. It was great.
Hi, you, look at you listening to the show. That's nice of you.
Yeah, that was interesting.
All right, cool. Nice to meet you, Sarah. Take care of yourself.
Nice to meet you, too. All right.